The 11th theory session of the problem-solving test course is devoted to the pigeonhole principle. If we have 100 sales managers in 33 cities, is it true that some cities have 4 or more sales managers? We'll find it out in a few minutes. Let us start with the following example. As always, pause the video and try to solve the question on your own, and then we'll check. Based on the information in Exhibit 1, which of the following statements is a valid conclusion? Exhibit 1. Duration and number of visitors for 2 most recent exhibitions at FATE. Duration in days, visitors, members and non-members for 2 exhibitions, Cometti and Shining Souls. Let's check all the options one by one. A. During the last 100 days, each day more people visited the Cometti exhibition than the Shining Souls exhibition. Well, this is actually something we don't know, because we don't know if the exhibitions took place at the same time or within the last 100 days. B. All non-member visitors to the Cometti exhibition also visited the Shining Souls exhibition. Well, this is easy to check. And this is actually false, because the number of visitors, non-members to Cometti, is about 11,500 versus 8,500 Shining Souls. So all of them could not have visited Shining Souls. And B is false. C. There was at least one day in which less than 100 people visited the Cometti exhibition. The total number of visitors to the Cometti exhibition is 12,631, and there were 120 days. So on average, more than 100 people visited the exhibition every day. But this does not mean that there is at least one day in which less than 100 people visited the Cometti exhibition. There might be such a day, for example, if on the first day only one person visited the exhibition. But there could also be no such days, if every day 100 people visited the exhibition, and on the last day, 100 plus everyone else, 631, visited the exhibition. So in this case, C is unknown. What about D then? There were days in which more than 90 people visited the Shining Souls exhibition. Let's write it down. The total number of visitors to the Shining Souls exhibition was 9,662. And there were 100 days, so on average there were about 97 visitors per day, which is more than 90. It seems that D is true, that necessarily there were days in which more than 90 people visited the Shining Souls exhibition, because the average is more than 90. But we can easily check that. Suppose the opposite, and suppose there were no days with more than 90 people, so that at most there were 90 people times 100 days equals 9,000 people. But this is not true, because the actual number of visitors was 9,662. That means the assumption that there were less than 90 people each day is false. Therefore, D is a valid conclusion. There is a useful result for solving similar questions. It's called the box principle. Its other names are pigeonhole principle and Dirichlet principle, after Peter Dirichlet, a German mathematician who created it. It states that if we got n items and we want to put all of them in m boxes such that m is greater than m, then at least one box must contain more than one item. The idea is intuitively simple. Suppose we have 3 pigeons and 2 pigeonholes. We want to put all 3 pigeons into 2 pigeonholes. If we want to put all the 3 pigeons into 2 pigeonholes, we must accept that one pigeonhole will contain more than one pigeon. The first 2 pigeons will occupy both pigeonholes. Then the third one will have to join either of them. The technique of proving this result, called proof by contradiction, is just as important and applicable to PST as the result itself. Once again, the result we're trying to prove here is, if we got n items and we want to put all of them into M boxes such that N is greater than M, then at least one box must contain more than one item. For starters, assume the opposite of what we are trying to prove. All N items are put into boxes and there are no boxes with more than one item. Now we will show that this assumption leads to a contradiction and as such has to be rejected. If there are no boxes with more than one item, the total number of items in the boxes is at most 1 times m equals m. But the total number of items is n, which is greater than m. Therefore, n minus m items are still not in the boxes. This contradicts the assumptions of our proof. Therefore, the assumption is wrong, and there is at least one box with more than one item. A general principle for k rather than one items per box also holds. If n greater than k times m items are put into m boxes, then at least one box must contain more than k items. The intuition is the same as before. Now we're just distributing k items rather than one. In the following example, we want to distribute 8 pigeons into 2 pigeonholes, 3 pigeons in each. Then there must be at least one pigeonhole with more than 2 pigeons. The proof by contradiction goes along the same lines as before. Assume the contrary and conclude that the assumption is not viable. How do we apply this knowledge then? Suppose we need to test an option in a conclusion question. We try to find situations in which the option is true and in which the option is false. If both are found, then the validity of the option is unknown. If just one example is found, we need to quickly make sure the other does not exist. To do that, we run mentally, or quickly on paper, a proof by contradiction and establish that the assumption of the example's existence leads to a contradiction. Here are a few examples. 20 pigeons, 10 pigeonholes. The claim is that at least one hole has more than 2 pigeons. We can show that there are examples when this is true. If there is a hole with 20 pigeons and all the remaining holes have just 0 pigeons. And then there is an example when there is false, when the pigeons are distributed equally among the pigeonholes. So the validity of the claim is unknown. Another example, 20 pigeons and 9 pigeonholes. The claim is that at least one hole has more than 2 pigeons. We can easily find an example when this is true. Again, put all the 20 pigeons into one pigeonhole and the remaining pigeonholes are empty. But the problem is that now, because there are just too few pigeonholes, we cannot find a false example. So let's prove that it does not exist. Assume the opposite, namely that such a hole does not exist. Let's take the claim that at least one hole has to have more than 2 pigeons and prove it by contradiction. So assume the opposite, namely that such a hole does not exist. You get 9 holes with no more than 2 pigeons each, hence you get no more than 18 pigeons, which is less than 20 pigeons overall. We get a contradiction. So the initial claim is true. Another example, 20 pigeons, 10 holes, and the condition that there are no more than 2 pigeons per hole. The claim is that at least one hole has less than 2 pigeons. We can easily find an example when this is false, when the pigeons are distributed equally. But the problem is that we cannot find the true example here. So let's prove that this example does not exist. So let's assume the opposite, namely that the desired hole exists and there are no more than 2 pigeons per hole. Then this special hole has just one pigeon and all the remaining 9 holes have 2 pigeons. And in this case, there are just 1 plus 2 times 9 equals 19 pigeons, which is less than 20 pigeons, and we get a contradiction. That means our assumption is wrong and the desired hole does not exist. The initial claim is false. It's high time for an official practice question on this topic. Pause the video now and try to find the answer yourself. Based on the information provided by the Orlando manager regarding staffing at the Orlando landfill site, which of the following statements is a valid conclusion? From the text, we learn three important facts. At least one environmental specialist is required 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The NGI landfill site is the only such site in the city, and it's open from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. from Monday to Friday. It employs 4 environmental specialists and 8 other staff. And then the total weekly employee cost is $7,000. Let's check all the options one by one. A. 1/3 of total employee cost for the landfill site is for environmental specialists. The validity of this option is unknown because there is no information about the cost of one employee. So we cannot calculate the share of total employee cost attributed to environmental specialists. B. At least one environmental specialist must work more than 40 hours per week. We know that at least one environmental specialist must be present at the landfill site 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. So the total number of hours is 168 per week. And we know that there are just 4 environmental specialists. So that means that on average, the environmental specialists have to work 42 hours. However, it does not mean that every one of them works 42 hours. But by the box principle, it means that at least one environmental specialist must work more than 41 hours and more than 40 hours. It's easy to check. Let's assume the contrary. Let's assume that all 4 environmental specialists work not more than 40 hours. In this case, their total work hours would be not more than 160, which is less than 168. We get a contradiction here. If we assume that all the environmental specialists work less than 40 hours per week, their total work hours are 160, and there are 8 hours in which none of the environmental specialists are present at the landfill site, which contradicts our first condition. Therefore, at least one environmental specialist has to work more than 40 hours, and B is true. C. Staff who are not environmental specialists do not work more than 40 hours per week. This is something we do not know because we do not know the work hours of not environmental specialists. We know the open hours of the landfill sites, but it's a different thing. D. The majority of the landfill site's employee cost is for staff who are not environmental specialists. This is similar to A, and this is something we don't know because there is no information about the cost of one employee. We know that the number of non-environmental specialists is greater than the number of environmental specialists, but this is not enough to conclude that the cost on non-environmental specialists is higher than the cost on environmental specialists, because environmental specialists might be more expensive. Hence, D is unknown. Let us synthesize what we have learned today. The box principle states that if n greater than km items are put into m boxes, then at least one box must contain more than k items. The intuitive result is easily proved by demonstrating a contradiction. The technique of demonstrating a contradiction is actually useful when we cannot find a false or a true example in a conclusion question related to the box principle. So much for the box principle. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below the video and I'll be happy to reply. Thanks for your time and see you later!